Okay, so the second most virulent species of bacillus is Bacillus cereus. And you know for a fact that there are two types of enterotoxin. So when we speak of enterotoxin, enterotoxins are type of toxin in which the intestinal cells are would be your target cells. And like, let's say for example, when you say neurotoxin, the nerve cells would be the target cells. So the two types of enterotoxins are the heat labile and heat stable. The difference when you say heat labile enterotoxin, those that are unstable in the presence of heat, those that are easily destroyed in the presence of heat. Unlike when you say heat stable, they can withstand even in high temperature. Okay, so mostly, heat labile enterotoxins are associated in food, that is actually unheated. Tama ka. Heat labile eh. So, ibig sabihin, pag init mo siya, unheated, di ba? Hindi mo siya init, nandun pa rin yung toxins. Okay. So, aside from these enterotoxins, we also have cerulean and phospholipase. So, Bacillus cereus can cause gastroenteritis, panophthalmitis, opportunistic infection. A while ago, we discussed Bacillus subtilis, which we can utilize the PLEP medium. Here, we can utilize the PIMBA medium, which stands for polymyxin pyruvate egg yolk mannitol bromothymol blue. So that's PIMBA. And the color of the colonies once positive for Bacillus cereus is blue. So the colonies are blue, they are rough and dry. So Bacillus cereus are this particular type of bacteria is common among immunocompromised hosts or those hosts with weak immune system. What are these individuals? Those that have HIV infections, okay, those that had undergone chemotherapy, okay, those who are drinking immunosuppressive drugs. Let's say for example they had just undergone renal transplant. Okay, so they can cause opportunistic infection of the eyes, in yung panophthalmitis. Their CNS could be infected. The bloodstream could be infected, or worst case scenario, they can even go as deep as your bone, causing you to have osteomyelitis. So, kahit pala kumain tayo ng food na may Bacillus cereus, hindi lang dun nag-stop yung problem, particularly if you are immunocompromised. For individuals who are using drugs, they have paraphernalia. Okay, so this paraphernalia can also be contaminated with Bacillus cereus. So that's why, you know, these individuals are usually thin, okay? They are not sleepy during lecture because, you know, they're very alert because of the drugs. Okay, so, yeah. So they have also to be careful because drug paraphernalia can also be contaminated with Bacillus cereus. Okay, so this is the appearance of the organism. So you notice gram-positive rod, but unlike Bacillus anthracis, the spores are not as prominent. Maybe because the picture utilized the spore stain. But unlike, they don't have the disjointed bamboo appearance of Bacillus anthracis. And unlike Bacillus anthracis, which is non-hemolytic, Bacillus cereus is beta hemolytic, so you can see clear zone in Bacillus in sheep's blood artery. Okay, so there are two types of food poisoning that can be caused by Bacillus cereus. One is called the emetic form, and the other one is the diarrheal form. Emetic form is implicated by heat stable enterotoxin, meaning that even if you eat the food, the toxin remains stable. Let's say, for example, rice. Rice that has been properly cooked, even if you have properly cooked the rice, the fact that the toxin can withstand high temperature, the toxin remains viable. So, the incubation period is very fast, in less than 6 hours, and signs and symptoms should include vomiting, nausea, and abdominal cramps. You won't have diarrhea, you'll just have vomiting. which could last for about 8 to 10 hours. Unlike the diarrhea form, wherein diarrhea is very prominent, aside from nausea, abdominal cramps, but this one is caused by heat labile enterotoxin. So, enterotoxin is heat labile and implicated in meat and vegetables, meaning if you will not be eating the food, then most likely you'll get this type of toxin. So there are things, there are food, certain food that cannot be heated, that shouldn't be heated, such as salad, cold cuts. So the incubation period would last longer, 6 to 10 hours, and the duration is also longer, about 20 to 36 hours. Okay, so there are other species of Ophidus. So these include subspecies like Helicornis, Circulans, Pumilans, and Spiritus. So let's discuss first Bacillus subtilis. The most common laboratory contaminants known as the A. Bacillus. During the finals, you'll have the unknown, right? Identification of unknown. You shall be given unknown bacteria. You have to be careful. Why? Because even if you disinfect, they contaminate your tabletop, disinfect it using Lysol, the organisms will still be viable because they have spores. You know, the only way you can destroy spores would be by means of autoclave. Or you utilize sodium hypochlorite, or Clorox, or Sunrox, pero dapat matagal. For long exposure. Okay? So this one is commonly found in soil. This one is the plate showing Bacillus thuringiensis. I told you the story about the BT corn and the GMO foods already. Okay. So another group of gram-positive bacilli is the Corine bacterium. The term Corine is a Greek term which means club, because the organism is a club-shaped organism. They are found as free-living saprophytes. So when you say saprophytes, these organisms are the ones that can live in decaying organic matter. So they are found almost everywhere, in water, soil, and air. And they are resistant to drying. And some of them are actually part of our normal microbiota. Okay, so the most common and the most significant, not really common, but the most significant pathogen is Corynebacterium diphtheriae. Take note on how you spell diphtheriae as species, and diphtheria is spelled differently as a disease. Okay, so Corynebacterium diphtheriae, which is quite difficult to speciate from other species of Corynebacterium. Other species may cause infections among immunocompromised hosts. So we just thought that there are contaminants, but in reality, if your immune system is weak, any contaminants could be opportunistic. So they are facultative anaerobic, gram-positive, they don't produce spores. They are club-shaped, that's why they got Corine. They are arranged in polyshape. What do you mean by polyshape? Side by side arrangement or appearance, as if there are cigarettes packed in a container. So they also have metachromatic granules. But there's a different term for metachromatic granules of Corynebacterium. We call it the Babe's Ernst granules. Sabi nga nung isang meme, buti pa ang Corynebacterium by Babes, kayo wala, no? Okay, so the Babes Ernst granules. So this is the term of the Corynebacterium. Okay, so Corynebacterium diphtheriae is distributed worldwide. But it's very rare in places where there is a vaccination program. Luckily, we have a program known as, we have a vaccine known as DPT. DPT is actually a toxoid. DPT, diphtheria pertussis tetanus. a toxoid. Why? Because diphtheria is an example of toxigenic bacteria. It's an example of toxigenic bacteria. So when you say toxigenic bacteria, it is the toxin that can cause the severe signs and symptoms. The toxin. Okay? And what is a toxoid? Toxoid is a weak toxin. It is an antigen. It is a weak toxin. Once given as a form of vaccine or immunization, the immune system of these children will produce what? Will produce anti, what? Will produce antitoxin. Okay? It will produce antitoxin. So, children will not anymore have diphtheria. Children will not anymore have pertussis, whooping cough. Children will not have anymore tetanus, or will not get tetanus infection or toxigenic infection. Okay? The diphtheria toxin is an example of exotoxin. Here's the deal. Not all bacteria, not all corynebacterium diphtheria, diphtheria, has exotoxin. How they will get exotoxin? They need to be infected with a bacteriophage. Okay, that will deliver the tox gene. Okay, so they need to be infected with lysogenic bacteriophage. There are two types of bacteriophage. One is lytic and one is lysogenic. So here the life cycle of bacteriophage. Okay?
During the waiting cycle of phage multiplication, the phage DNA is replicated and transcribed to produce additional phage DNA and proteins. The phage components are assembled into virions at the cell lysis, releasing the phage virions and killing the host cell.
Okay, so you notice here, the bacteriophage infect the bacteria and they divide. Once they have several numbers, that causes lysis. Okay? The other one is lysogenic. This is the lysogenic life cycle. This is the type of bacteriophage that has infected the corynebacterium. So look what happened.
In contrast to the lytic cycle, the lysogenic cycle does not cause lysis and death of the host cell when the phage genome is copied. Instead, the phage DNA is incorporated into the host chromosome, producing a prophage. The phage DNA is copied whenever the host reproduces.
So
in a rare spontaneous event, or in response to certain stresses, the phage DNA becomes excised from the bacterial chromosome, leading to initiation of the lytic cycle.
Okay, so let's say for example, this bacteriophage, the green thing that you see here is actually the tox gene. Where does the toxigen come from? The toxigen comes from the bacteriophage. So the bacteriophage infects corynebacterium, and the green thing, which is the tox gene, is incorporated now in the chromosomes of the bacteria. And then the bacteria divides. So you now have corynebacterium with tox gene. You understand? Corynebacterium without tox genes, they are non-pathogenic. Corynebacterium with tox gene, they are toxigenic. Corynebacterium without tox gene, they are non-toxigenic. Okay, having seen the animation, we can therefore conclude that only toxin-producing bacteria can cause diphtheria. If the bacteria is not infected with a bacteriophage, then the bacteria will not have the tox gene. Then it is not therefore toxigenic. Okay, so toxin is an antigen. Thus, we need an antitoxin to neutralize its effect. Okay? So most of the organisms are pleomorphic. What do you mean by the term pleomorphic? The term pleomorphic, what does it mean? It means that the organisms are what? Would have variety of shape. Variety of shape. So different shape. They are sometimes referred as the Chinese characters. Miss Tan, ano ibig sabihin nito? Basahin mo nga. Ito, ano ibig sabihin nito? Totoo ka ba Chinese or joke lang? One word. Okay, sige. Ayan, so, this is an example of Chinese character. Okay, pleomorphic organisms. Pero it doesn't mean anything, sorry. Doesn't mean anything. So, it appears like as if you are looking at Chinese characters. Okay. So, the toxgen, therefore, is introduced by lysogenic bacteriophage. Okay? So, what's the action of the toxgen? It can block protein synthesis by inhibiting peptide translocation. So, organisms that would have that are bacteria, ulcerans, and pseudotuberculosis. Aside from that, we also have the dermonecrotic toxin. Okay? It's actually an enzyme, sphingomyelinase, that could increase vascular permeability, ulcerans, and pseudotuberculosis have it. And then hemolysin, it can cause, obviously, hemolyzed RBC. Corynebacterium pyogenes have that particular type of virulence factor. Okay, so the toxin, I think I've told you already. So let's discuss now the toxigenic Corynebacterium diphtheriae. Okay, again, the bacteria becomes toxigenic once they are infected with the bacteriophage and they possess the tox gene. Now, there are two fragments of the toxin. Okay? We have the active fragment and the other one is the B, or the one that binds. So, you won't forget A for active, B for binds. Okay? The active fragment, they call it active, because this is the actual one that could inhibit protein synthesis. Okay? Why protein synthesis, once it is inhibited, why is it very important? Because once you inhibit protein synthesis, it's significant rather, because it can cause to cell death or necrosis of the tissue. That's why, once you are infected with diphtheria, you have the so-called pseudomembrane formation. Okay, pseudomembrane formation at the upper respiratory tract, merong pseudomembrane. So necrotic cells, ibig sabihin yung mga tissues dito, they're all dead because the toxin prevents protein synthesis. Okay, so the B fragment binds two specific cell membrane receptor. What does it mean? Without the B, the A fragment cannot enter the cell. So B serves as the advanced party before the A fragment can enter. So they are equally important. Okay, so these are the two fragments of toxigenic bacteria. Okay, so how do you get diphtheria? Luckily, all of us are immunized by DPT because that's actually part of the program. Okay? Unless you were born somewhere in the mountain without a pediatrician, so your mother didn't consult any pediatrician at all, then you didn't have any vaccine, didn't receive any vaccine. But for most of us, we have been vaccinated already with DPT. So that's why it's a very rare disease among the children, as far as Philippines is concerned. Especially nowadays, but during the 70s, early part of the Philippine civilization, I would tell, this is actually a common disease. Okay? How do you think they get it? By respiratory droplets. Aerosols, okay, hand-to-mouth contact, okay, mostly if you are unimmunized. Okay? So, you get, the incubation period is very short, more about 2 to 4 days. You'll have a low-grade fever, you'll be very weak and you have a mild sore throat. So the formation, so the membrane formation has actually started building up. Okay? So because of the local toxin production that causes necrosis. Okay? How would you say there's a necrosis? There's a pseudomembrane. It starts at the tonsils and then it will spread downward the larynx and trachea. And the pseudomembrane, it is as if you have a cement case somewhere in your tonsil and it will block the way you breathe. Okay? So, di ka makahinga properly. And the thing is, it will irritate your throat. So, you keep on coughing until there's such, so there will come time that you already coughing out blood because of the trauma as forceful coughing. Okay? So, that's pseudomembrane. See? So that this one is an example of the pseudomembrane. Not part of your upper, not part of your tonsil. This one is your tonsil, right? But this is the pseudomembrane. What is it made of? Made up of bacteria, lymphocytes, plasma cells, because you're trying to fight it off. Made up of fibrin, dead cells. Why do you think cells die? Because of the toxin. Okay? It covers the uvula, the tonsils, and even the palate. You know where the palate is? Pwede mag-cover yan ng pseudomembrane. Tapos, bababa yan hanggang sa trachea, which is your windpipe, di ba? Pag na-block yung trachea, paano ka pa makakahinga? Di ba? That's your windpipe. Okay. Another type of diphtheria is the cutaneous diphtheria. Most prevalent in the tropics, infections occur at the site of minor abrasions. Okay, so that's non-respiratory. Systemic means it is absorbed in the bloodstream, becomes multi-organ infection, and the reason why people die is because of the cardiac failure, kinarja. Okay, so ayun. Affects the kidneys, hearts, and even the nervous system. Okay, now here comes a part of the role of medical technologies. How do we identify Corynebacterium diphtheriae in the lab? It's not every day that you have the specimen that says, that the request says that the doctor is suspecting for diphtheria. So that's why it's very rare to have this in the lab. Okay, maybe because of the successful vaccination program. This is it. We have to identify it properly. So we can utilize Tinsdale medium in which the organism will form brown halo, and the reason why it's brown halo because of the action of cysteine sulfhydrolase, which acts on ferrosulfate in the Tinsdale medium. Egg and serum medium, that's a medium enriched with egg and serum, such as the Pais coagulated egg. And the other one is the Loeffler serum slab. The most commonly used is the CTA blood agar plate, in which we can classify the colonies as Gravis, Mitis, and Intermitus. The Loeffler serum agar is very good because it can demonstrate pleomorphism. Here you can have Chinese character appearance when you look under the microscope, and you also have the Page's earth granules. Though you need to have a special stain for you to see the metachromatic granules. The CTA buck is the modified Tinsdale. Here we can classify the organism as the colonies as Gravis, Mitis, and Intermitus. What does it mean? If you are able to observe colonies that are large, flat, dark, gray, irregular, straightened, and look like basic M. So those colonies are classified as Gravis. Why? Because most of the time, Gravis colonies would cause the most severe disease. Okay? If you are able to observe colonies that are small, black, glossy, condensed, translucent, and appears like fried egg, you classify that as Mitis. Ibig sabihin, Mitis colonies would have mild diphtheria. And something in between them is the Intermitus, characterized by colonies that are small, flat, dry, gray, and black. But if you're using that other plate, they are colorless. Okay? So, moreover, these three types of diphtheria or helicobacterium can also be differentiated according to hemolysis and hydrolysis with starch. Okay? So, only the mitis group is positive for hemolysis, and only the gravies can hydrolyze starch or glycerin. I think that's glycogen. Okay. So, here's an example of the mitis. Okay? Colonies, intermedius, and gravies. The one that, okay, yeah, the one that have the tasty hair colonies. The gravies. Okay, pinaka-gravies sa lahat. Parang hindi yung malimutan. Okay, ito yun. The gravies colonies. Tasty hair appearance. Okay. You can also do the fermentation reaction. Okay? And the other one is the urease test. But the organism is toxigenic. And there are two ways for toxicity testing. In vitro and in vivo testing. The in vitro test is known as the ELEC test. The in vivo test is known as the animal inoculation test. Okay? But nowadays, we just have to look for the tox gene in PCR. That's much easier, but actually more expensive. Okay? So, PCR, DNA amplification. So, here's the ELEC test. Okay. ELEC test, you have here, okay, this is the paper strip. And the paper strip has antitoxin, impregnated with antitoxin. These are the suspected colonies. Okay, so this is the negative control. Okay, so this is the negative control. This is the positive control. How would you tell if it's positive? You observe for precipitin line. Okay, so this is, if there's a lot. So if there is a arc formation, you call it lines of identity. So if there's an arc formation, this is the patient sample. If there's an arc formation in between the patient's bacteria and the positive control, then that is considered as positive reaction. So ibig sabihin yung pasyente positive sa corynebacterium na nag-produce ng antitoxin. Pero kapag dito naman siya sa negative control, nagkaroon ng ARC, sabihin, doon siya identical sa negative control. So, precipitin line, therefore, is the positive reaction in ELEC test. Ganun kasimple yung ELEC test. Okay. Hindi katulad ng in vivo test, kailangan mo pa ng animal inoculation. So, dalawang klase ng animal ka meron. Isa, labeled as test. Yung isang animal, labeled as control. Okay, ano yung ibibigay natin sa test? Yung suspected bacteria, i-inject natin. Sa control, ano yung ilalagay natin? Yung C-diphtheria plus antitoxin. Okay, kapag namatay yung test, yung control buhay, ang ibig sabihin nun, yung bacteria na nasa test, ano talaga siya? Corynebacteria na toxigenic. Bakit hindi namatay yung control? Tingnan ninyo. Kasi yung control, merong antitoxin. Okay. Paano kung buhay pareho? Siya yung non-toxigenic yung organisms. At paano kung patay pareho? Ibig sabihin, the toxicity is not due to diphtheria. Kasi, bakit siya namatay and may antitoxin na? Baka iba yung reason kung bakit siya namatay. Okay? So, yun yung animal inoculation test. So, ano madali? ELEC test or animal inoculation test? Siyempre, ELEC test. But the problem with ELEC test, it is an animal inoculation, non-specific siya. Okay? So, that's why a more specific test is yung PCR, wherein we look for the tox gene. Schick's test is the skin susceptibility test. We want to know if the person is susceptible to diphtheria or not. Okay? So we have the test arm and then the control arm. 0.1 ml toxin lang yung bibigay natin sa test arm. Tapos kapag nagkaroon ng redness or swelling sa test arm, sabihin you are susceptible to diphtheria. 0.1 ml lang na, hindi 1 liter. Baka mamatay yung pasyente kapag 1 liter, okay? So yun yung chick test. So according to your study table, 16-1 of your book, so that you'll be able to identify other tests for diphtheria. Okay? And how do we treat diphtheria? We administer antitoxin. Okay? So, but you also have to use antibiotics to clear the remaining bacteria. Okay? Antitoxins are produced in horses. So that's why other people will also develop hypersensitivity reaction towards that antitoxin. Kasi antibodies na mga horses to. Okay. Other species would include the JK. Ito yung common name niya. Or the JQ. Infections from catheters or prosthetic devices. Prosthetic valve endocarditis. And then the pseudodiphtheriae can cause opportunistic infection or endocarditis. The pseudotuberculosis. Usually you get it upon contact with sheep. Or dermonecrotic toxin, and then the striatum can cause rare infections but still part of the normal flora. Ulcerans can cause mastitis in cattle. We can get it if you get into contact with cattle or we drink unpasteurized milk. Viralyticum, it's actually a pathogen can cause UTI, and your urinary positive. Cirrhosis can cause skin and mucocutaneous infection, can also infect prosthetic valve, and eventually cause endocarditis, bacteria, and pneumonia. Then the macrocauti, kasi they have a weak handle. And then the minutisum can cause erythrasma of skin. JK, ito yung JQ mo kanina. And then yung diphtheroids, ito yung diphtheroids. Ito yung mga non-toxigenic diphtheria. Ibig sabihin, ito yung mga karina bacterium na wala pa toxin. So they are normal flora, shorter, but they also have lesser metachromatic granules. Okay, so I think these are the tests that will allow us to differentiate diphtheria from ulcerans. So remember, diphtheria are positive in nitrate reduction only. But ulcerans are positive in both urea hydrolysis and trehalose fermentation.